Welcome. Thank you for joining us. Before we watch the celebration of our Mass, we pay homage to an African saint, Saint Cucuphas. The portrait is graphic. It depicts the murder of Martyrdom by slitting of the throat of Saint Cucuphas. Cucuphas was born into a noble Christian family in Sicily, Africa Proconsoris. He and Saint Philip, later martyred at Tyrone, were said to have been deacons of the Christian church in Carthage, who arrived at Barcelona to evangelize the area. According to his legend, he functioned as a merchant in Barcelona while preaching the Christian faith, baptizing converts, and aiding the Christian community there. According to a Christian's account of his life, he was generous with the poor and a worker of miracles. He was martyred near Barcelona during the persecution of Diocletian. Under the Roman government, he suffered many torments and was imprisoned somewhere near Barcelona along the 20-mile stretch between ancient Barcino, Barcelona, and Igarda, Tesrassa. His throat was finally cut in 304. Tradition holds that two Christian women from Iluro, Batara, Juliana, and Sempronina buried his body and were subsequently martyred as well. The Benedictine Abbey at San Cugat del Valles is considered to be situated on the site of the martyr, which was once the Roman site of Castrum Octavino. The legendary details of his martyrdom state he was handed over to 12 strong soldiers who were ordered to whip and tear his skin with iron nails and scorpions. Cucuphas is then roasted alive after being covered in vinegar and pepper, though heavenly intervention saved him from death and injury. A great bonfire also failed to kill the saint, and instead killed his would-be executioners. His jailers were then subsequently converted to Christianity after they found Cucuphas in his cell, illuminated for heavenly light. The next day, he was flagellated with iron whips by means of heavenly intervention. The prefect Maximinus was killed when his carriage caught on fire. Rufus, the new prefect, prudently decided not to practice the torture of any kind on the saint, and instead ordered his immediate execution by the sword. When the first Benedictine community gathered at San Cugat in the 9th century, the monastery dedicated itself to the pre-existing veneration of Cucuphas. Since the 8th century, San Cugat has claimed Cucuphas relics. In the 8th century, Saint Fulgurad took a relic of Cucuphas from San Cugat to Saint Denis. The relics of Cucuphas occupy a place of honor in the ash to the right of Saint Denis to this day. From the 14th century onward, San Cugat kept the martyr's remains in a small chest decorated with scenes of the saint's life. This chest is taken to the parish of Saint Cugat del Rey, or del Forn, in Barcelona after the monasteries were freed from Mormon. In 1950, Saint Cugat commemorated a relic proceeding from this chest of Saint Cugat del Rey. The relics are now kept in the crypt of the Basilica of Santa Maria del Mar. Many churches in Europe from the Middle Ages honored, claimed his relics, including Reichenau, the cathedrals of Braga, Oviedo, and Lippe. His monastery was founded by Fulad, who had already brought some of the saint's relics to St. Denis. veneration in France. The saint is venerated in Paris with some of his relics enshrined at the Church of Saint Denis in the Chapel of Saint Cucuphas near Rue Malmaison. A forest is named Forest de Saint Cucuphas, and a tiny lake carries the French name. Property of the state since 1871. The forest is called Bois Berlinger until the Benedictines built a chapel dedicated to the saint in the 13th century. Pilgrims to the shrine of Saint Quickback were practiced until the 8th century. Other place names may point to Saint Cucuphas cult in France include Guillemillat, Tonkat, and Copien. Veneration in Spain. The Diocese of Girona has several parochial churches dedicated to him. Concern among Catalan devotees of the saint was raised when it was discovered in 2001 that the name of Saint Cucuphas had been removed from the latest version of Roman Martyrology. However, the saint had been included under his Latin and English names of Cucuphas rather than Cuca. In martyrology, he was described as a martyr of the persecution of Diocletian, killed with the sword 4th century after. Saints Julian and Semperina are still venerated at Martyrdom on July 27th. They appear with Cucuphas in the facade of the Church of Santa Maria de Martyrdom. In folklore and tradition, people pray to this saint when they lose things and are not able to find their belongings again. Some knots are made in a handkerchief with a cord, an allegory that represents tying the testicles of the saint. Then a prayer is performed as follows. Saint Cucuphas, your testicles I tie, and until you do not find my lost belongings, I will not untie them. He is generally not associated with any special patronage, although Angel Rodriguez Benagurian writes that Joan Amata's Costumary Catella mentioned that anciently hunchbacks venerated Cucuphas as their patron saint, as well as those who committed petty thefts. The origins of this patron are not known. Tithes and offerings, all I have is yours. Remember everything that God has given to you. Father Andrew Charles Smith, Jr., also known as Father Drew, pastor of Holy Angels Catholic Church, Chicago, Illinois, 60653 U.S.A., presides over the Mass with Deacon Bruce McElrath, Deacon Mervin O. Johnson, Mr. Tyrone Pittman, Minister of Music, and Executive Director of Music for the Chicago Black Catholic Choir. Videographer, photographer, cinematographer, Gregory Evans Callaway, webmaster and lead web developer, Djere. Contributions, Holy Angels Catholic Church, 615 East Oakwood Boulevard, Chicago, Illinois, 60653, USA.
Thank you. United States. We ask that you do not take it for a man. The 11th city has instances for the control of the soul of this father of Hudson, requested by her mother, Mrs. Daisy Washington, and her sister, Mrs. T. Hill. Also passing instances for the control of the soul of Djere people. They need to continue to rest in paradise, requested by Mrs. Piper B. Please stand. I gather this all here. Order to be on Christ. Hymn 246 in the lead guide.
Draw near to your servants, O Lord, and answer the prayer of unceasing kindness. And for those who glory in you as their creator God, you may restore what you have created and keep safe what you have restored. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A blessing over our children and teachers. Heavenly God, we ask that you be with them as they go forth to learn the good news that you have prepared for them from the beginning of time. May they learn to the best of their ability, and may the teacher teach to the best of hers. And we bless you in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's second reading, the reading from the letter sent to Paul in the Ephesians. Brothers and sisters, I declare and testify to the Lord that you must no longer live as Gentiles in the futility of your minds. That is not how you learn Christ. Seeing that you have heard of me, and were taught in him that truth is in Jesus. That you should put away the old self of your former way of life, corrupted through deceitful desires, and be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and put on the new self, created in God's way in righteousness and holiness.
Thank you. My sisters, my brothers, may the Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. When the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into boats and came to Capernaum looking for Jesus. And when they found him across the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" Jesus answered them and said, "Amen, amen, I say to you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate the loaves and were filled. Do not work for food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For on him the Father, God, has set his seal." So they said to him, "What can we do to accomplish the works of God?" Jesus answered and said to them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in the one he sent." So they said to him, "What sign can you do that we may see and believe in you? What can you do? Our ancestors ate manna in the desert, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." So Jesus said to them, "Amen, amen, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave the bread from heaven. My Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." So they said to him, "Sir, give us this bread." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never hunger, and whoever believes in me will never thirst." And my sisters and brothers, this is indeed the good news of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Good afternoon, man. Tall and beautiful, but short and loose. We have wider hallways, but narrower possibilities. We spend more money than we have as money. We buy more. We have bigger houses than smaller families. We have more conveniences, but less time. We have more degrees, but we have less sense. We have more knowledge, but we have less judgment. We have more experts, but we have more problems. We have more medicine, but we have less wellness. We have multiplied our possessions, but reduced our values. We can't seem to take care of our own business because we're always wrapped up in somebody else's business. We talk too much, especially about things we don't know anything about. We love to sell, we hate too often. We've learned to make a living, but we have not yet learned to make a life. God has called us to be better and to do better. Being that we are created in the image of God, God knows no limitations upon what we can do. We need to pray. We need to recognize our need for prayer. We cannot survive without it. Celebrating the funeral of Master Saint Martin of the Forest yesterday on the west side. 44-year-old man. The church was proud. Evidence that he had a lot of love. Evidence that it's not how long you live, how well we live. Then I found out after the funeral, a friend of mine, 50 years old, died of a heart attack. But God had a good day. That's why we got to get up every day with a smile on our face and say, thank you, Jesus. Even when things are going wrong in our life, we got to say, thank you, Lord, because we know you're going to bring us to the storm. Life is not easy. That's why the Apostle Paul wrote to the church in Thessalonica, be joyful always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. We serve the mighty God. Today's gospel, the crowd was at Capernaum looking for Jesus. While we're looking for Jesus, we read in the Bible, Jesus tells us himself, amen, amen, I say to you, you are looking for me, not because you saw signs, because you ate your fill of the loaves. They want to set up fulfilled lives. They missed out that Jesus provides in times of hunger and thirst. And I stopped by here today to tell you, my sisters and brothers, it's not what Jesus provides, it's that he will provide. The Lord will not give us everything we want, but he'll give us everything we need. They missed the message. They missed that a little becomes much when you give it to Jesus. Jesus can multiply whatever he gives. When you offer a life to Jesus Christ, the gospel will feed the world. Life of Jesus won't be the subject to the hunger and pains of materialism or the stubborn grounds of self-interest. Jesus offers an alternative to fast food. You can go to McDonald's, you can go to Burger King, and you can get it as fast as you want. But that's only temporary. Jesus gives us food that lasts. He tells us don't be concerned with food that perishes. But the fruits of Jesus' word have eternal life. If you believe in God and the God sent his Son, and that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life, if we believe that, why are we still hungry? What do we really want? The continual assault on African American by the police. You think with all the video cameras out here, they're going to slow down. Purpose, Baltimore, Cincinnati, Chicago, the list goes on and on. I could probably name every city in America. Can you imagine what would happen in Cincinnati if that camera was not there? It would just been another dead human being. So much going on with Planned Parenthood. So much going on with poverty in our world. So much violence in the world. Iraq, Iran, everywhere. All of these things have the power to break our spirit. All of these things, if we do not believe in God, have the power to strip us of our faith. Even right now, some of us don't know if we're coming or going. Some of you may feel like I feel. If one more thing goes wrong in this church, I'm going to lose my mind. I know you're hot up in here. I'm burning up to you. I got nothing to love for you. Believe me, take it from my soul. I've been doing everything to get this air conditioner up and running. It's going to happen. But we're going to need a collective effort here. They tell me that both the compressors are shot. We need a new air conditioner. But it's okay, we're going to get it. I'll talk to them after mass. We'll deal with that. And the real economy. But I feel good. I stopped by the game just 1 or 2 years ago. I'm sure because the Bible tells us that his name is Jesus. Mary is his mother. He is the Son of Man. The one sin and an eye open. Jesus connects himself in God's ministry with various things throughout the gospel. We see in John, he said he has several I am statements. Recall in Exodus 3 when Moses asked God, who you should tell the Israelites sent to him? God answered, I am. Today's gospel, Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Bread gives sustenance to the body. But Jesus is a genuine bread. He descends from God. Jesus said of himself, the scriptures bear witness to me. Before Abraham was, I am. That's the good news, my sister and brothers. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is the showbread, the mercy seat, and the bread of life. Without Jesus Christ, your life is empty. Truth is his garment. His hand is strong and his right hand is ready. Justice and righteousness are the pillars of his throne. Love and truth will walk in his presence. Everybody's going through something. Just sitting in that church early, wherever it was, but what's that, you know what I'm talking about, wherever it was, when I saw their family, when I saw their faces, when I saw the pain, but even in the midst of the pain, I saw peace. Because they understand there's a reality. And this physical world is not the ultimate reality, the spiritual realm is, because that's where God lives. God is amazing. God can bring us out of some of the most difficult times of our life. That's why we see amazing grace. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I once was blind, but now I see. I'm not fearing anybody today, my sisters and brothers. I feel good. I might be hot. I might be burning up here, but I still feel kind of cool. Don't worry about the pain. Don't worry about the drama. As long as we live, there's going to be some pain. As long as we live, there's going to be some drama. As long as we walk the earth, somebody is going to say something about you, especially if you're doing it. My second reading from the letter of St. Paul to Ephesians, the Apostle Paul lets us know that there are only really two ways of living. The way of the wise and the righteous, or the way of the foolish and the wicked. We all got to do better. We see on the news all the time so much clowning going on with the police. But I drive by the community and I see so much clowning going on with us. It's on 53rd and Lakeshore Drive. Seven youths about 10 and 11 years old thought it was a good idea to try to cross Lakeshore Drive. Now, no one knows. Only one mistake, and they're dead. God's called us to do better. We must hear the word of God and believe. We must let that word transcend us and transform our very being. God has called each and every one of us, and that's why we are here today. Never let it matter the call. The call transcends human status. It exceeds human strength, and it confounds human will. To God in the world. No matter how evil the forces might be in the world, no matter how overwhelming your circumstances may seem, I stop by here to tell you, God's got the victory. Sitting around talking to one of my boys, they have the nerve to say, oh man, somebody says such and such about you. I don't know if you want to be the reactor, but I only have one thing to say. Do you know where I am? God is real. He sits high and mighty on the throne. Put your faith in him and not in man. Some hope your eyes are cast in silver and gold. I boast in the Lord, the servant of the Lord. No matter how captivating things may seem in your life, no matter what you're going through, God has got the victory. These forces are not supreme. Addictive forces are not supreme. God is supreme. No matter how invisible you might feel, no matter how on the radar God, you might think you're fine. The scripture makes it very clear, the Lord chose you before the foundation of the world. We are hungry and thirsty people. We're hungry to sin. We're thirsty to be known. We're hungry to have meaning in our lives. We're thirsty for recognition and affirmation because we are children of God. But they put it like this in Psalm 139. Oh Lord, you have searched me and know me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. How is that for being saved? And how is that for being known, my sisters and brothers, who can know so much about you and still love you? Only Jesus. The Bible says, bring to him every anguish. Bring to him every confusion. Bring to him every perplexity and anxiety. That's good news. In the midst of this hot church, when you reach out and touch God, he'll change your hand. I'm not worried because I have a touch with the Lord. I have a touch with the one who made heaven and earth. Never give up. Never quit on life. Remain in Jesus, and Jesus will bless you and fix you up. Don't quit. That's the first thing the devil wants you to do when difficult times come your way. He wants you to quit. Don't live by your situation. Live by the promises of God. That's why we walk by faith and not by sight. I know for a fact there's a blessing on the other side of faith. Put your faith in Jesus. Don't look at your provision. Look at your vision. And without vision, the people shall perish. You must give a word of hope, my sisters and brothers. We must give a word of forgiveness to those who hurt us. We must share with one another, love with one another, and bend so that we won't break. We must seek unity in spite of our differences. The Bible says, come to me all you who are weary and burdened. I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest in my souls. I read somewhere in Isaiah, that they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint. God's promise. That's why Psalm 34 says, I will bless the Lord in all times. His praise shall always be among us. I've been in Holy Angels 3 years. Every day gets better. I need to get out of this time. Every day gets better. And every day I realize that I'm among the people of faith. Every day I can say thank you, Jesus. I don't care how difficult it would be. It's kind of hard right now. The air is out. The roof is leaking. Parking lot's got a sinkhole. But we shall overcome. I was reading a song the other day. I'm so encouraged. Because the Bible is a supernatural document. It is beyond this place and this space and time. God is good. And when the songwriter said, he said, if you trust in the Lord, he'll clothe you in a robe of salvation, wrap you in a mantle of justice, give you strength and temptation, perseverance and endurance and pride. He'll make you enemies of Christians. Then he'll bear you up on the breath of God, mount you up on eagle's wings, and make your face shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. He is the very God. He is the great I am. Hold on to his unchanging hand.
Jesus, you're the center of our joy.
Thank you. Oh,
Almighty God, in the prayer of the family and gathering before you, continue to lead God just to justice. We ask this in the strong name of Jesus Christ, my Lord. Amen.
Our Lord is able to lead the
for my brothers and my sisters, and my sacrifice and all, and be made acceptable to God and the Almighty Son. Graciously sanctify these gifts of the Lord with grace, and keeping the relation of the spirit of sacrifice, make of us an eternal offering to you in Christ God.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and
just. It's truly right and just. I do it in our salvation always and everywhere. To give you thanks, Father, most holy, your beloved Son, Jesus Christ. Your Word, who made all things, whom you sent as our Savior, we made, incarnate by the Holy Spirit and the Word of the Lord. Fulfilling the will and gain for you, all holy people, he stretched out his hands as he endured his passion, so as to break the bond of death and manifest the resurrection. Mm-hmm. And so with the angel and all the saints, we declare your glory, and in one voice we are. death and resurrection. We offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence. Humbly we pray that partake of the body and blood of Christ, you may be gathered as one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring us to the fullness of charity together with Francis, our Pope, and Blaise, our bishop, and all the world. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection. All who died in mercy, welcome them to the light of Christ. Have mercy on us all, with the blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God. Blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, so we may merit to be co-heirs of eternal life, and may praise and glorify you in your Son, Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
your constant protection over you. Those who return with these heavenly gifts, and in your never failing care for them, make them worthy of eternal redemption in Christ. Amen. Please be seated for a moment. I know it's hot, it's been out there real fast, but we have to. Thank God for your presence. Thank God for your faith. The faith of one person is truly awakened faith of another person. Well, thank you very much, God bless you. Now it's hot.
Members in the Tennessee, please see Lord, you can have the mask and the wrap tickets.
You know, everything that the blessed sacrament does comes 100% back to the church. So they're selling the raffle tickets for their stay-at-home team, and it's going to be $2 each or $3 to $5. Also, please come to the flea market. It's going to be Saturday, August 22nd, at 9 to 4. It'll be right here in the lot. So please see Pat Wilson of Pavetta to get your attention. And thank you to Pleasure Council number 200 for having a single trip on August 15th. I'm interested in contacting Richards right in the back there. And please fill out those information cards right now that will probably sit so that we can get your name into our records. Thank you.
We do have a special guest with us in the Tiffany, could you introduce our guest, please?
This is Gary and Sylvia Washington. They're friends of mine. They cook out with us in Winfield, Illinois. And yes, we'll Calvary, of course. But Sylvia is the Justice Conference that we're having also been saying to me here at the church. She's an environmental justice scholar and really interested in helping the Black Catholic community about not only
coastal
and
physical,
but the importance of the environment, climate change, and
all that. So, could you come up here for a second, please? Because I think it's very important. It won't take long. Dr. Sylvia Watson. Dr. King said, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. And when they talk about churches, churches really broad, it encompasses the whole spectrum of life, from the cradle to the grave. So give us some words.
Thank you.
First, like I say, it's a blessing to be before you as a fellow Black Catholic. I'm also an official validator for the Pope's encyclical by the Catholic Climate Covenant. For my fellow players, my husband and I are the former founders of the first player court and council of Joliet Diocese, 4366 St. Joseph and Peter Court. So the first time I ever had the opportunity to speak to Black Catholics was really because of the players who, with their support, allowed me to write a grant for several $100,000 that was funded by the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops and the National Religious Partnership for the Environment. And after having gone to my honor to train my Vice President Al Gore's Fund of Reality Leadership, they announced that Pope Francis was coming out with the encyclical on climate change. For those of you who have had an opportunity to read Laudato Si, Our Common Home, one of the things that struck me, because the Players Project lasted 4 years and we was exposed to 5,000 Black Catholics. One of the things I understand, I know some of you are in your heart, is that my mother died in 1988, a very faith-filled Black Catholic woman. She died because she was diabetic and metabolic syndrome. Because her heart couldn't take the heat. I had the same situation. Every Black person in America with asthma, diabetes, obesity, any kind of problems with oxygen. Those are the people we know as physicians and public health specialists who die from heat change. So this is not some esoteric, abstract issue. In 1995, my husband and I lost the heat to our house. I was 4 months pregnant and I missed hearing. So global warming and climate change, the frontline communities that the Pope talks about, he's talking about us. So we need to understand what it is that we need to do to protect our communities, and we do it as Black Catholics who want to protect life from the very beginning to the very end. When we lose our elderly, we lose our children, we are destroying our communities. So please, when you think about this, come out, hear what we have to say, hear what you can protect yourselves, hear what you can spread the word. And let us not get into divisions about, oh, this is environmental stuff. We have Black Lives Matter. Black Lives do matter. And surviving heat is part of this. Thank you.
Thank you all. Please stand. The Lord be with you. Almighty God, bless you. Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Our celebration has ended. Let us go forth and remain on the battlefield for the Lord.
Our closing song will be found in the reading back to hymn number 80. This is my God.
Sunday Mass closing prayer. Thank you for worshiping with us. Be sure to join us again next Sunday. Until then, log on to our website, http://www.holyangels.com for Father Drew's weekly message and God's Praises Tell, which features an interview of Father Drew by Andrew Light, Director of the Office of Black Catholics, Archdiocese of Chicago, on the Holy Angels Church website at http://www.holyangels.com/node/95. Also read Deacon Bruce McElrath's weekly blog, an explanation of the Holy Angels Church mural, which you are currently viewing, can be found on the Holy Angels Church website at http://www.holyangels.com/node/5. Until we meet again, may all that you do give glory to the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. Amen. God bless. See you next week.